the administration, I would like to welcome you to the open forum on the proposed dress and grooming policy for the Chambersburg Area School District. It is evident by all of you here tonight and by all of the conversations occurring in every corner of our community that this is indeed a very popular yet controversial issue right now. We have received a tremendous amount of feedback about the current dress policy and the proposed dress policy. Some negative, some positive, and some right in the middle. Your voices, your emails, your tweets, and your Facebook comments have all been heard, and we do appreciate your input. Thank you to the individuals who have contacted committee members and board members, and who have done so in a constructive and professional manner. From all of the comments, one common theme seems to be pervasive and persistent. That overall, improvement in dress, in some form or another, should occur in the Chambersburg Area School District. At this time, I would like to share with you the format for this evening's forum. I will start by giving a brief overview of the committee, our visits to other districts, and the purpose behind the proposed policy. I will then introduce our guests from the Sharon School District, Mr. John Sarandria, Superintendent, and Mr. Len Ridge, High School Principal. Mr. Sarandria has implemented a dress and grooming policy in two of his school districts and has done so very successfully. Mr. Rich has had the opportunity to implement a dress and grooming policy in his current district from the ground up. He has seen the concerns and the outcomes of implementing a dress policy. The next part of the forum will be a PowerPoint presentation of the proposed dress policy. I will highlight for everyone what clothing is permitted in the proposed policy. Finally, the end of the forum will be time for questions to be asked to the panel. Many of you received 3x5 cards on your way into the auditorium this evening. If you didn't get a card and would like to ask a question or make a statement, please raise your hand and someone will be around to give you a card. The staff members will pick up your questions and we'll use those at the end of this forum. During the panel discussion, we will answer as many of your questions as possible. And if we do not get to all of the questions tonight, we will put the questions and the answers on the district's website. Tonight's forum will end promptly 7:15, so that the regularly scheduled board meeting can take place at the administration building. There will not be a vote taken tonight at the board meeting about the dress and grooming policy. At this time, I would like to share the overview of why and how the dress and grooming committee met today. Over the course of the past several years, many community members, board members, employees, and local business leaders have discussed at length the need for our students to dress more appropriately for the benefit of the community, but more importantly, for the benefit of the students. And over the years, the current dress code tried to be enforced but failed because of the amount of difficulty in interpreting the guidelines within the policy. This has caused and continues to cause much frustration among parents, students, and teachers. Even today, with the current enforcement of the dress code at the secondary schools, there are still issues because of the interpretation of the policy. That being said, I was directed 2 years ago to chair a dress and grooming committee to create a dress policy that could be enforced. course for all students K-12. I solicited volunteers to join me in researching the topic and thoroughly understanding it from other districts' perspectives, and doing so in order to find a balance that would have a positive impact on our students. The members of the committee included parents, students, staff, board members, and administration. I would like to introduce some of the committee members who are here this evening for the panel. Mr. Nelson, principal and parent. Ms. Cesario, principal. Ms. Schuyler, assistant principal. Mr. Leonard, music department chair. Ms. Sharp, former board member and parent. Ms. Smith, current board member. Mr. Smedden, business teacher at Cassis. And Dr. Pavasic, superintendent. Please know that this committee went into this with extremely open minds about a dress and grooming policy for students. Some of the committee members actually volunteered to be on the committee because they were not in favor of a dress code. Also, please understand that at no time was this ever to be a punishment to our students, nor an inconvenience to our families. But what we wanted to do, we wanted to reduce conflicts in our schools. We wanted to curb the violence, and we wanted to promote learning. We wanted to prepare our children for professional life on a daily basis, but we wanted to do so in a manner that allowed children the opportunity to express their individuality. We observed strict uniform policies with white shirts and khaki pants. And we decided against that because we wanted our children and parents to have more options. We made it our goal to talk to the students and the parents and districts to hear their stories. And we heard the same stories, that it was a rough first year, but their schools and their students themselves benefited from a dress policy in numerous ways, and all commented that they were so much better off since the implementation of the dress policy. We looked initially at our own dress and grooming policy and found that it was too difficult to be enforced on a daily basis due to the level of interpretation of the policy. What was acceptable clothing to some teachers and administrators was not acceptable to others. We looked at what would be sustainable for many years to come, and we took several things into consideration as reasons for a dress code policy. The safety of our students is the number one reason for moving forward with a dress and grooming policy. Public schools have the responsibility to have safe and orderly schools that maintain an environment conducive to learning. This is one of the main reasons school districts across the United States are implementing dress codes. The National School Boards Association reports that dress codes show a decrease in violence, a reduction in fights in schools, and improves the ability to pay attention academics. Creating an appropriate dress code in Chambersburg is an avenue we can use to help reduce conflicts stemming from socioeconomic status, as well as a way to decrease discipline issues while increasing pride in our students and our community. With 47% of our district school children considered economically disadvantaged, it is imperative that we be concerned about the great needs of our local families. 47%. Almost one in every two children is considered economically disadvantaged. We do appreciate all of your comments and concerns about the legislation of our community, and we are fortunate that we all want to provide. We believe we can do so by implementing stress policies. After visiting Sharon School District, Cleveland School District, Blue Mountain, Reading, and Hazleton School Districts, one common theme was clear to the committee. For the benefit of our community and our students, something needed to change for improved stress. Another thing that became clear was the need to start with the staff. So last year, the staff dress and grooming policy was created and approved by the board. It started the first day of this school year. The staff dress and grooming policy is being enforced with every employee in the district. We've received comments from parents and students about the positive and professional change in dress among our staff. In summary, as stated earlier, we all understand that this is a controversial issue. But we believe, as a committee, that we have done what was asked of us by researching and collecting as much information as we could on the topic and presenting a dress code that is right for our students. We believe that the proposed dress code has the ability to raise the standards and expectations for all of our students. At this time, I am pleased to welcome and introduce our guests from the Sharon School District, Mr. John Sorandria and Mr. Leonard Rich. John is the superintendent of schools in the 11th Forest and his high school principal. They're both here today to share their story about moving their district forward with the dress and grooming policy. Thank you. We're going to have just an overview. Mr. Sorandria had the opportunity to start dress and grooming policy as a high school principal. We'll share a little bit about that. And then as a superintendent, get the opportunity to take Mr. Rich along, and they have some interesting comments to hear about that. So, Mr. Sorandria.
Well, good evening, everyone. I want to compliment all of you for coming out here this evening. I think the most important thing that any parent can do for their child is participate in their education, the address, academics, extracurriculars, and therefore, so we all compliment. A funny thing happened on the way to the dress apparel policy that we put into place in Newcastle, Pennsylvania, when I was a principal. I was asked to lead a committee, and unfortunately, I was vehemently opposed to the dress apparel policy. I didn't think we needed it. I felt like we enforced the current code with a little bit more tighter language that wouldn't be necessary. I was kind of a thorn in everyone's side as we progressed through the policy. I came to realize that over my objections, this policy was to be. Lo and behold, after 5 years of being principal with the policy and now another 4 as a superintendent, I can unequivocally tell all of you it's one of the best things that we've ever done in our buildings. Now, I'm not here to try to sell you on the dress code. Not why we're here. We're here to tell you why it works in our district and why it could work in yours, if that's the desire of the board and the administration and the community. Now, just like when I was a high school principal, Mr. Rich was told by me that the board had instructed me that they wanted the committee to be formed, and we were now going to implement some sort of a policy or corrective to the current dress code in Sharon. And of course, like me, looking in the mirror, he was vehemently opposed to the dress code. And he said to me, Mr. Sorandria, with all due respect, I don't think we need one, I think it's not, but really it's not necessary to go to the vehemently opposed. And I don't mind saying that he was a thorn in my side every inch of the way until the policy. And now, just like we started. candidate, now he can speak for himself, I'm going to pass the microphone over to him, about what he's seen and what the benefits are. Very quickly, just so you're aware, we went through the forming phase, we went through the storming phase, which obviously, that's where it is in Chambersburg. Then it'll go through a norming phase, and then after 3 or 4 years out of clearance, you'll go through a performing phase. So here's what we've seen in Karen as a result of the implemented testing. Going through exactly to an auditorium with this many people and more in smaller schools, going through exactly what you're going through now. We saw a major reduction in overall discipline referrals from the teachers to the principal's office. So we have to elaborate more on that. We saw a spike in school pride and in school spirit in our district. It's already been in long traditions and well traditions. A school district with a lot of pride could even increase that if that was possible. And then so what I listed third, but was also very, very important, is the community enhanced. The community was enhanced by the way the students looked and by the way they traveled through the community. It gave our older residents and it gave our younger residents who were very, very influential and were looking at the older kids something to be proud of and something to
wonders for the socialization of the school district and the calming effect for the buildings. Students were dressed for school. They were in their school clothes. The $4 polo from Walgreens or the $25 polo from Aeropostale or American Eagle or wherever else is a polo. We call our school spirit shirts Tigers. We're this year in Tigers. So if you're a club sport or activity, you can sponsor a t-shirt and they can wear that t-shirt to school with the appropriate bottoms. Ladies can still look fashionable, can still look like ladies due to the numerous accessories that we allow. So again, these are things that work for us. We saw an approximate 25% reduction in the overall number of discipline referrals to the office between last year of the old dress code and the first year of the dress apparel policy. Now, one thing, although the number of referrals decreased, one of the things that was emphasized was the new dress apparel policy, so obviously there was more documentation and enforcement of that policy. So, we felt that, and we don't need to have an orange and black day, those are school colors and tigers, because every day they're in orange, black, white, or gray. It does go a long way. We have had to speak to Mr. Granger's public relations piece. Numerous parents over the years have complimented us on how good the children look K through 12, and also how good they look in the community because they have their school clothes on. From a financial standpoint, because I know that's a concern, obviously, if it works in the 11th Board School District in the state, it could work for you as well. In that, if, for example, if a boy has three pairs of khakis and five t-shirts and a few polos, those are things that could stretch to So, I wish you luck on whatever you decide to do and whatever works for the Chambersburg community. And once again, this is what is work for the Sharon City.
One more piece. Dr. Joe, I wanted to tell you that I recently had a board meeting with Sharon, and we moved away from grass and started to talk about PSSA school. And this was prior to the sports being released, so the meeting we had to share all of the board. And I prefaced my comments to the board that once you deal with the mind, you look at the scores. And there's one thing I need to know, if the scores were to drop in some of our schools, would you still love them? And the president of the board looked at me and said, of course we'll still love them. And what Michigan do? We moved on from grass and have concentrated on trying to raise our PSSA in the process. But let me just tell you one of the other approaches that we use in order to put this in place. And this is right on the PDE website, and you can still find it if you search. And it's called the holistic approach to education. And that's meaning educating the student academically, physically, socially, and emotionally. And here is a graph that I've left with your administrators that they can share with you at another time that has six different bullet points that deals with that. And three that you could actually attribute to being able to accomplish with class. One is high expectations, not only in the classroom, but in appearance. Skills for life. Certainly we know that there are different requirements for dress depending upon the occasion and the setting. And then the last one, I think, is really important because I think our kids struggle with this nowadays, and that's setting clear and consistent boundaries about what is appropriate and what is socially acceptable and what isn't for school, for the workplace, for church, or at home, on the playground, on the football field, wherever that might be. Those are three very, very important areas when you're looking to holistically educate the student. So we do focus quite a bit on academics. I think everybody knows that. I know that you know in Pennsylvania, there are very, very strict rules now towards what we can serve in our cafeterias and physical education. Socially, all the anti-bullying things that are out there, I think those are very, very important. And then the emotional well-being of all students. When you're in a poor school district like Sharon, the 11th poorest school district in the state. I keep looking at the list. I know we're going to crack the top 10 soon, but we haven't cracked it yet. And I will tell you that it's like a tale of three different cities. We have three different elementary schools, one in a very wealthy part of town, older money, beautiful homes. They attend our largest elementary school. We have one elementary school that borders our neighbor to the south, Farrell School District. That school district is 90% free and reduced lunch, 50% African American. And then we have one that borders on the state of Ohio, which is predominantly Caucasian and has a 100% free and reduced lunch. In fact, in the summer, in the two last elementaries that I mentioned to you, we served 8,000 free lunches. 8,000 free lunches in those two schools. 700 kids go to both of those schools. Now, in our district, in seventh grade, everybody comes together for the first time. So they go from their small elementary, the largest is 600, to a building of about 1,100. Sixth graders going from the big kids on the block, and now to the new kid on the block at the big band of high school. And I can tell you that a lot of change takes place for all of those students. There are a lot of things that they're going through, not only because of their age, because now they're with everybody. Now they're with everybody. So they're very self-conscious. And we really have felt that both in seventh and ninth grade, the implementation of this policy has leveled the playing field. And it's much more difficult now to determine between who the haves are and who the have-nots are. And you might not believe this because we don't always accumulate data right now to this fourth point, but many, many, many kids get off of the way they're dressed. They don't have 150 all very thankful. Their clothes were a little bit old, maybe their hands. They go through that, and a lot of kids, as a result of that, you might not believe this, but they'll tell their parents, but they won't tell them why, but they'll tell their parents, I don't want to go to school. I'm being harassed. I'm being bullied. Now that happens in other areas as well, but we find that one of the most popular areas that kids get bullied in are their parents. So it doesn't eliminate that problem, but it certainly does level the playing field. So thank you.
At this time, I'd like to share with you the dress and grooming policy, the proposed dress and grooming policy that we are looking at moving forward for approval, looking forward to working with the community over the course of the year to be implemented. Okay, I wasn't expecting that. PowerPoint, screen. Thank you. Very good. The purpose, and I think we shared some of this already, and it is part of the actual policy, is to strengthen the learning environment for classroom instruction and academic performance. To prevent disruption to the educational process, prevent distractions to student, staff, and the educational process. We believe that we'll be able to facilitate learning and increase school safety. We also are very concerned with peer pressure and believe that we can avoid peer pressure regarding dress. We really want to increase the atmosphere for school pride and personal appearance. And then finally, we would like to enhance the image of students and the at this point, what we've done is, through all of our travels to the other districts, we've taken several pieces of those different dress apparel policies and worked with our committee to make it more of our own. I will say that the students were a key component in this, as they oftentimes shared what their thoughts were about the new dress apparel committee, and it really was allowing us to open up to what they want. The tops are permitted in any solid color and must have collars. Polo style shirts, Oxford shirts, dress shirts, turtlenecks, and mock turtlenecks. Sweaters, including crew neck, V-neck, full-length zipper, and half zipper. Boat necks, vest, sweater vests, and cardigans may be worn as part of a layered outfit with a collar, turtleneck, or mock turtleneck shirt underneath. No more than two top buttons may be unbuttoned on any style of collared shirt. And that, of course, addresses the issue of inappropriate bleeding. No more than, shirts must have finished seams and include sleeves, collars, and shirt sides. Students are not required to tuck in tops. And that was a common theme, actually, with a lot of the districts. They wanted their students to tuck in shirts, and we decided that that was not something we felt necessary to do. And tops are not to go below the mid-thigh. Spirit wear is a real nice way for students who enjoy wearing the t-shirts to continue to wear t-shirts. Other t-shirts are obviously prohibited, but school-sponsored crew neck t-shirts and sweatshirts and crew neck sweatshirts are permitted. These will have Trojan logos on them. They will have spirit wear from patches from all of the elementary schools. They will have anything along the lines of athletics, music programs, and even drama clubs, and so on. The PTAs and the PTOs will be involved with this so that they can have a part in helping us with creating peer wear. crewneck t-shirts and sweatshirts can be purchased from local stores. We also would like to involve our own business department here in Hatchet in regard to designing some of those shirts by our students. Bottoms are permitted in the following solid colors: black, blue, gray, brown, and khaki. Corduroy pants and dress pants, capri and cargo pants are also permitted. The following are permitted but must be no shorter than 2 inches from the top of the knee: skirts, shorts, dresses, and jumpers. Leggings and tights are permitted in the following solid colors: black, white, brown, gray, blue, and khaki. All bottoms must be worn at the waist and have a finished hem, so there will be no sagging. Dresses and jumpers must have a collar, which would be the appropriate top. Dresses and jumpers must be no shorter than 2 inches from the top of the knee. Must be a solid color and have a finished hem. Footwear. Are required to wear closed cell footwear, obviously for safety purposes. They can be made of canvas, plastic, rubber, leather, and fabric. Dress shoes, athletic shoes, garden crops, and boots are all permitted. And footwear may have a back or also be backless. At this time, we're going to be taking some questions, answer the questions of panel discussion, and Dr. Cadassa is here to help us do that.
Okay, we'll get started. There are several themes that come out across the week in these cards, and I'll read the questions and ask the panel to answer them. Some of them we don't have answers for. We are a public school, we understand that. But we can enforce a dress code. So that's been a question asked by a lot of people. We are a public school. Yes, we are. We also have rules. Okay, so number two question has been a theme. Are we going to vote on it? You. 9 school directors are elected in this community to represent this school district. 62,000 residents. They will make the decision at this board meeting a month from now. In other words, the last week of the last Wednesday of October. So that's the process for democracy. Your input's being heard here now, and we'll try to ask as many questions you have here as possible. As I said, we won't get to them all maybe, and then we'll get them on the website. Okay, this isn't an open forum, thank you. Okay, the first question here. What are the current statistics of bullying increments caused by clothing currently in a school district? Does anyone want to answer that? The question was, what are the current statistics for bullying in the school district that led to this policy?
Caused by clothing.
Okay.
With regard to specific data for the Chambersburg School District, what we have done is we have not specifically collected data per clothing.
In other words, we don't know the
answer. But what we've done.
Please be quiet. We do not have statistics. That's clear. Okay. Anything else you want to add, Kathy? Okay. What is your goal? What is the goal of this policy? I want to answer that.
Well, I believe that I tried to make very clear tonight that the goal and the purpose of the policy, as you see behind me, is for us to decrease those areas where we have concerns, yet increase other areas. We want to make sure that our students are safe. We want to make sure that our Would be really nice to have one voice.
Person who decides when a violation of the dress code is broken?
The teachers and the administrators will be responsible for enforcing the dress policy.
You don't enforce it now, how can we expect you to enforce it later?
Again, that is the whole reason that we are trying to put this in place so that it can be.
Thank you, Kathy. The next question, what about children with special needs?
They all got special needs.
You're right. Yeah. All children do. We would like to...
Ma'am, you do not have the floor.
Part of the policy, we do have exemptions in the policy, and we have any student with special needs, we obviously make sure that everything that is included in their individual education plan is followed completely. So we will absolutely work with any parent who has a child with special needs to make sure that they are comfortable in the school setting and that they feel as if they're in a safe environment.
The next question is, why? Go ahead.
Just wanted to say that
you're not part of this board.
As a parent of two special needs children at home, I can tell you that every accommodation in our policy, with working with the parents or any medical needs for students, religious and otherwise, are respected and honored in our policy, and I don't care.
Thank you. The next question is, why can't the current dress code be enforced with stricter penalties or even fines?
I think we all all work together, we can come to an agreement and work with your PTA. So,
thank you, John. Very good. The question was, the current code, why can't it be enforced?
Why can't it be enforced? I think what's there right now in the handbook can be enforced as it is. We can't add to it because, number one, we didn't agree on that. And what's in the book is in the book. But for the new coming year, we can't add to that. And with the help of the student council, and so that all the students get together with them, we could come to an agreement, and like I said, with the PTA. And but I am a firm believer right now, giving the principals and the teachers and Mr. Chappell, just say, hey, this is what's in the book, this is what we're going by this year, nothing more, nothing less, and just show them that right now. Thank you.
One more question. We have some elementary principals on the panel. I'd like to hear from you and why elementary children would need this.
The question was why elementary children?
Yes.
In the elementary level, we set the standard for when they come into education and how they should act in the building. So when they come through the elementary ranks and move into secondary, we've already laid the groundwork. Now, if we would say do not include elementary, that could lead to some household conflict when they're in secondary and elementary as well. With the new proposal, if it goes through, some of the clothing can be passed down to those elementary students as well.
Okay. What metrics are being used to measure the result? What metrics are being used to measure the result?
What we will do is starting the next school year with whatever dress and grooming policy we have had approved by the board, we will be taking statistics from day one as to any of the disciplinary actions that have occurred with regard to dress and grooming. I will say that several of the districts that we met with, they explained that every year they would meet with a group of people to discuss the current policy and see if there were any places that needed to be adjusted or readjusted. And so that would certainly be something with regard to looking at the data that we get from the disciplinary infractions and working with the faculty, the staff, and the community on what things we think that we need to change in order to make it better for everybody.
The further question on this was, how will you accurately determine that the dress code results in a change expected and is not the result of other initiatives? Anyone have an answer to that? How will you accurately determine that the change desired was from the dress code, the change in dress attire, expected and not another initiative?
Well, I think that just from hearing our guests from Sharon, they've been able to see a difference immediately in their change in dress. So we would certainly hope that would be the case overall.
Thank you. Will families be able to receive a tax write-off for all uniform clothing items purchased?
No.
No.
Okay, the answer to that is no. Is that accurate? Please define the problem that the dress code is attempting to address.
Don't say bullying.
Excuse me, please. I'm trying to respect you. Please try to respect people on the panel.
The question was, please define the problem that the dress code is attempting to address.
I can, as a parent, tell you one problem that just happened today. I'm a seventh grade girl. And I think there are some of you parents out there who have seventh grade girls.
very insecure. And she had such a difficult time this morning because she was sure her clothes didn't match. They were beautiful. It didn't matter how many times I told her that. She was so insecure because she did not want to go to school and have someone comment about her clothes. And I'm telling you, my daughter is not the only one who has those issues every morning. And to send children to school feeling insecure already as soon as they're locked out of the house. Kids are cruel. And they are... But kids are a rule. I will not see my children. One thing it does is it takes, when we went to visit, we talked to students, we went to a high school cafeteria and asked students, what do you dislike most about the dress apparel policy? And it was, for most, you can't wear denim. For some, boys especially, you can't wear athletic shorts. What do you like most about the dress apparel policy? I don't have to make decisions in the morning. And I can leave the house knowing I'm going to be fine, and there are going to be other kids who are dressed kind of like me.
Anyone else is kind of like, okay, thank you, Renee. The next question, what percentage of the current student population is not following the current dress code?
1/3 of 1%. We have issues even with our current dress code in the secondary schools on a daily basis. The first period of every day is just dealing with dress code violations. And so that's something that our students are missing out on.
Speaking from the high school perspective, I've been working with the dress apparel, current dress apparel policy this entire year, and we started off strong on trying to get the children to understand what the policy was. We had a couple of meetings. We had student leaders identify what the current policy was and put it in their own words so that our students could understand what it was. We have asked our teachers to be diligent in the dress apparel policy. You're asking for statistics. All the statistics I can show you right now are on a clipboard in the main office of the dress apparel violations that I have dealt with and a few other administrators. I can't give you a percentage because there's things that happen throughout the day that you need to understand. Students come to school dressed inappropriately. Teachers send them with a pass to the office. They stop by their locker. They change their clothes. They come, and you don't see what the violation was. We're trying to narrow that down and get it in writing. The other thing that happens, we have children that come to school and have first, second, third, seventh period gym class. They don't always go in dressed with what they come out with when they have to change for gym. So those changes are being made. Can we catch every single student who violates the dress apparel policy? No, we cannot. Are we doing the best that we can? Yes, we are. Because if you as drivers followed every rule of the road and got caught every time you didn't, not one of us would be sitting here.
Thank you. The next question. What part of the current dress code is too subjective and not able to be enforced?
The most difficult part right now at the high school level of the dress apparel policy is, you've heard it, is the tops for ladies. That is very difficult and a hard one for us to address. It makes it very difficult for our male administrators and teachers to address that. I've addressed a lot of that. I've spoken with ladies very candidly about how they look and what I am seeing as a female to a female. That's a tough call, but that is the most difficult. The second one that we are still working on are the saggy pants for the gentlemen. Because they pull them up, they sag down, they pull them up, they sag down. That's the second one that is very hard to address. We are really trying to get a hold of that one, especially starting this week.
And I add, one of the, what I think is a great thing about this dress apparel policy that addresses that modesty issue is when you wear a polo or a button shirt, you can only unbutton the first two buttons. That is easily enforceable, it's easy to see, and it's easy to understand.
So, ma'am, you're saying that it's
not... From the elementary perspective, we do a lot of short shorts, inappropriate footwear, recess, and pop some of the girls. Inappropriate footwear is a huge one for recess.
Thank you. The next question, what is the purpose of not allowing stripes or patterns on the shirts?
We are considered now by the Department of Education and Urban District, and I will tell you that we purposely went to Cleveland School District because we wanted to see what the issues and concerns were there. Their demographics are in many ways similar to what we have here. And I will tell you that there are a great deal of gang-related issues in this school district. Those same gang-related issues are filtering into our school district, whether you want to believe that or not. I assure you that it's me. And what happens is, striped apparel is known for gang affiliation. And so we want to make sure we're trying to keep everyone safe. We don't want gangs infiltrated in our district.
Okay, thank you,
Kevin. Another issue with the right lighting. If we have a building that height of 572, I can look at a crowd for all of you and I can see if there's one student that has something inappropriate, which would be striped to write. Now, everybody has regular stripes. We have to read every single shirt. 2 days ago, we had an Andrew Burke share that said, get the block out. So we have to read every single shirt. So that eliminates reading shirts in the room.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, the next question. When you say spirit wear will be permissible, are you saying that you can wear t-shirts, sweatpants on a daily basis as long as they have the school logo on it only on specified days?
Spirit wear is related to tops and not bottoms. And everything that your child has that is related to Trojans, that is related to their school, that is related to their club, any extracurricular activity, any elementary school is acceptable as long as it's crew neck, t-shirt, or sweatshirt, no hoodie sweat.
What about the name of the baseball team?
The next question. Students attending FCCPC are required to wear, quote, shock t-shirts while at FCCPC. Their time at the magnet school consists of 90 days. Will students be permitted to wear their FCCPC t-shirts at the magnet school?
Yes. Yes, that would be considered spirit wear. Yes.
Wear it on the magnet school.
Yes.
Yeah, we don't save it in the last one. Watch out. It is going to require a large amount of time, effort by administrators and staff to enforce such a strict dress code. Do you feel that the time spent on this will be taken away from learning time? And otherwise, the gaming attention that could be spent on this activity.
As with any new policy, when you first put it in place, you spend a lot of time. First of all, educating people on what the policy is and enforcement. But over time, as people adapt to the new change and the new policy, you spend less and less time on that policy, and you're allowed to spend more and more time on education.
My daughter has 2 years. How long is it going to be before she gets educated?
As Mr. Andrea indicated, okay, there's a process to go through, okay? And it will take time. We understand that. But it's not going to take years and years. Okay? Because we've already seen a change this year in enforcement of what we're trying to do with the dress apparel policy here now. We've seen a change.
He said 5 years.
Okay. Ma'am, we're going from a page and a half
Sean,
to 7 pages.
Sean, would you like to address again the amount of time it took you to put your change in?
The next question is.
So you're not going to educate her.
Because this is not a private school, how much money will be given to each student for clothing allowance?
We will be working with local community, local companies to work with buying large amounts of clothing so that we're able to get it at a reduced cost so that we are then able to make sure that the students that are receiving free or reduced lunch are able to get those at a very inexpensive rate.
I don't have money coming out of my ear.
So, in the same kind of question, what is the cost of implementing dress code on a yearly basis will become a line item in the budget. This time that has not been determined, right? Is that correct?
How should taxpayers pay for it?
And there's another question similar to that. Basically, while the school board approved this dress code and spend money on doing this instead of putting the money into more needed things.
You already know where my stance is, but I do have this proposal, and I think it could really work. No matter if it's with the dress code that's in the book and we embellish on it, but I would actually like to see a store in each one of the grade schools, each one of camps north and south, and the high school. Is something for the kids and the students to do, and it would be like their own boutique. Now, I know, it's like, oh, use clothes. Really, it's like, kids have so many clothes out there. It's like, you know what? As long as it's falling into the school policy, we can have it in the school store, and you can be fixing it up. You could be doing displays. You can have pictures up of what's appropriate. And it just opens up the door for a lot. And then we could give vouchers out to the students, say, for 3 outlets, all right? And just a minute, please. All right, in the store, just as you would go into some place, of course, we put a price on it, the kids do. And it's all open to everybody to come in, all right? If they could purchase, they want to. Because it's like, I love to go into a secondhand shop and purchase. I mean, you find a deal, and it's like, oh, wow, that's a great top, that's a great whatever. And it's open to everybody to come in. That money then could go into an account, and then however the student council wants to use it can be used. But it opens up the door for kids to come in and shop at a discount rate. And like I said, if there are people, students, that have are on a budget, then just we can give them the voucher system. And if you want to, then, you know, you bring 3 pieces in.
We're all on a budget.
Yeah, we are on a budget. Everybody could come in there, all right? But you bring in pieces in, and then you'll get a voucher. Say you bring 3 pieces in, all right? And then you get a voucher for yourself, and you could purchase. You don't even purchase it. You could just get the voucher and pick something out. Because just like with any wardrobe, they say get rid of three, can purchase one. And I think it's a great idea, and it gets the students involved, and it's actually pretty exciting. And that way, the parents get rid of the kids' old clothes, follows into the school policy, and gives the children a lot of creativity and ideas. But it's just a thought that maybe we could look at doing something like that, because I don't believe that it should be a burden on the taxpayer to have to pay for vouchers for, because really, the middle class is hit hard. Okay?
Okay.
We're going to talk about that.
We have two more questions, then I'm going to ask the panel for a wrap up. And another question is, have you considered a compromise? Has someone considered a compromise?
We have worked pretty diligently on making sure that we have worked. Excuse me.
And the panel will have a chance to ask.
So let's ask them what their policy was whenever their children violated their dress code. Did they send their children?
Have you considered a compromise? We will get to that. Okay, we have two more questions and we'll have the panel open again. Number one, has there been a compromise considered?
We are certainly not closed-minded at all in any way. I assure you that the comments, the questions, and the concerns that you have had over the past 2 weeks have been taken very seriously. I will also tell you that I've met with several groups of administrators, of parents, who are interested in some changes. Are we open to that? We most possibly are. I am. That is absolutely not the truth. And we're going to be meeting with people even tomorrow to discuss options.
Okay, thank you, yeah. And of course, the last part of that question was feeling that maybe we're going too far with this particular policy versus what we have now. What I'd like to do now is basically go down the panel, and Mrs. Saranda, you folks can answer them. You've heard some of the questions here, and please feel free to order them.
I did hear one lady ask about the consequences. In our school district, the consequences, first of all, for elementary students and secondary students are completely different. We certainly assume that in a lot of cases when elementary students come to school out of compliance, it's not due to anything deliberate, an honest mistake. So certainly a little note home is a reminder as to why the student is out of compliance, and that can be corrected without any interruption with the learning process. On the secondary level, there's a continuum. You know, the first offense is always something that can be corrected right on the spot. You'll find that what students will do in time, just like they do now, sometimes the building is a little colder, a little warmer on different occasions. They'll keep different things in their locker that they'll be able to change into. In fact, in case there is a violation, having been around high school students for almost 30 years, I will tell you that a lot of kids leave school, they go to their friend's house on their way to school, and change when they get there. And when we call a parent to come in and bring a change, if they're able to, when they get there, they'll see their child and say, well, that isn't what he or she wore to school when she left the house. So we deal with that sometimes. But I guess to answer your question, you try in every way, shape, or form to minimally impact them losing any instruction. If the situation can be corrected right on the spot, unless it's something that's happening day after day after day after day. Now, I don't know, I'm afraid to say this, but I'm going to. I don't know what the culture would permit here, but in Sharon and in Newcastle, we had something called Saturday detention. And to a certain level of violation with the dress apparel policy. There were some hours on Saturday that students need to come in and do some work. Now, that's up to the school, and that's up to the board, and that's up to you, but we found that very effective. They weren't losing any class time. And then they thought twice about it when they had to be at school at 8:30 in the morning on Saturday. And we all know what teenagers would rather be doing than that. So hopefully I answered the question.
I want to address nice lady's questions about it. Here's another thing. Do they have to go to 7:15? If you have some questions, again, we're happy to explain how it works in our world. You have to define it for your own world. I understand that. Depending on who the student is, some I know better than others. Some I know their parents better than others. You know, we catch a lot before school and during first period, as we should. To answer some questions earlier, I live 30 miles away from the school. I speed every day. I don't get caught. But when I get caught, I got to pay the fine. If we catch a student and he comes down, we'll tell him, can you make a corrective action? No. Is there someone you can call it on? If the answer is yes, then either the parent will bring something in or the student will go home to get it and then come back. If the answer is no and no, then they go to in-school suspension for the remainder of the time. Now, let's say someone's working and they get off at 7 a.m. By the time they get home, whatever, they're going to be in around 9. Well, it turns into a de facto holding thing. As soon as they make that corrective action, then they're allowed to re-enter the environment because they're now adhering to the school rules. Depends how quick they are to be dressed appropriately. I'll be happy to stay and answer questions for you if you want.
What if the kid has a car accident when they have to go home and change?
At this time, I know that it is coming to the close of the open forum. I would like to share with you. Thank you for your comments, and we will move forward on the dress code. Thank you.